Welcome to the 6th annual Digitas NewFront 2013. Thank you, Douglas. Very inspiring rant. Douglas, and he took all my material, particularly about the jeans and the getting laid part. Douglas writes in his new book that if the end of the 20th century can be characterized by futurism, that the 21st century can be defined by presentism. So what does this present look like for us at this moment? It's interesting, in the last few weeks alone, we've seen some startling news that reminds us how different our present is right now. For example, we learned recently that AOL will now be distributing content on cable television with Access TV. We discover that 20-something sensation Jenna Marbles has over 1 billion views on YouTube. Oh, and speaking of YouTube, just yesterday, DreamWorks buys Awesomeness TV for a deal valued at $150 million. And we've heard a lot about Netflix. Now, more subscribers than HBO. Who would have thought that would have happened? And a $100 million investment in House of Cards with 13 episodes released at once for what we all love, video binging. This digital video market is now a $4 billion market. It's 41% bigger than last year and will double again in the next 3. That's a big number to watch. Here's another one. My back of the envelope math says that all the premium original digital content that you're seeing this week is the result of more than $1 billion of production costs being put into the market. That's a lot of investment. That's twice what Paramount spends in a year and the same that Warner Brothers spends in a year in production. Big numbers and a lot happening. But so what? What does this mean for us? What it really means is that we're witnessing and living in a rapid-fire terrain where change is as fast as a blink, a pin, a post, or a tweet. And digital video is now a viable business. We at Digitas are very proud to have played a role in helping make that happen. It was 6 years ago that two of the pioneers of the space and two of the driving forces behind this event, Jordan Bitterman and John McCarris, invented the term NewFront in a Las Vegas hotel room. And thank God. And in this case, thank God what was said in Vegas actually didn't just stay in Vegas. It has transformed our lives. It has transformed your week. It has blown up your calendars. It turned what was otherwise a simple couple of events to go to into a nonstop parade of breakfast, lunch, dinners, parties, and standing in the rain to get into an event. I hope you'll notice that the doors opened on time and that we have as many seats as people we expected. It's the little things. But honestly, it's more than about the video. The question in the moment is about context. And it is the context that determines whether that content lives, thrives, sometimes dies. The real now, as Douglas said. So you're hearing a lot about original premium content this week. Today's conversation in here is going to be on the all-important context. Because in the right context, your brand content will thrive. It will be alive. And that is why the theme of the 2013 NewFront is Your Brand is Alive. Today's NewFront program is here to inspire and stimulate, but not sell. We're here to help you, our client partners, navigate this terrain and come out better equipped to win and beat your competitors in this fast-growing space. So, please have some fun. Please enjoy this knowledge tour. And in the spirit of us trying to create conversations with our consumers, I encourage you to engage in conversation today. Be active, lean in, meet people you haven't met, and help create an interesting set of stories, maybe one, maybe two, maybe 10, that'd be worth sharing. We've assembled a diverse and remarkable group of storytellers to help us do that. These storytellers will be covering a lot of ground. They'll get you thinking about the value brands bring when they're in your pocket, the role a CMO now plays in the digital world, and how data is at the center of driving it all. So let's get started. It is my pleasure to welcome an iconic storyteller who's breaking all the rules as she evolves from print to digital, a legendary film producer who is jumping from the big screen to YouTube, and a chief marketing officer whose brand has been at the center of stories for over 110 years. Please join me in welcoming Tina Brown, Mark Hansricker, and Jules Daly in a conversation moderated by Alison Norrington of Story Central Digital.
First challenge I thought would be getting on the stool, but I seem to have managed that, so that's one story not to be told, right? This is really exciting, and I'd like to thank you all for coming and welcome you. In listening to what Douglas had said, both out in the green room and out here, about presentism and futurism and fragmented storytelling, it made me realise all the more that I feel us guys are here now to stand up for story. We come from various aspects of storytelling, and I'm quite excited to share some ideas with you. But I think that also what was said is something about context, and the context, I feel, is something that's at the heart of storytelling that can't be ignored, because in the noise of fragmented digital storytelling, without a context and a theme, we don't have anything to hook onto. So I'd just like to ask some questions to say, you know, as storytellers from like linear, print, performance, theatrical, brand advertising, all what you guys do, how important has it been for each of you to try and nail down the core DNA or the message or theme of your stories and your brand? Maybe I'll start with Mark Hans.
Oh, all right. Hey, everybody. Little energy here. Come on. New front. So stories are about what the story means. Stories are kind of boring unless it sort of leads to a meaning. And for us, it's really about what's the meaning, not advertising, what media you're using, whatever. It's what's the story between the people, not just from us to them. Mm-hmm. And facilitating that meaning is the most important part of my job and what we really deliver as a company. You know, we sell more than motorcycles. And the meaning has to be more than just one definition for one type of person. It has to be a central meaning that spreads across many different types of people. So you might be providing something as big as the idea of like personal freedom, but that might translate differently for a young adult than it might for a woman or for someone in a different country. So it comes down to that central idea, ideal, more so than the tactics that you use to deliver it and how it translates between people, not just from the company out.
See, I feel like for Harley-Davidson, that kind of underlying philosophy of freedom or free-spiritedness is something that's quite inherent to the brand. So it's quite kind of easy, perhaps, to communicate that out to your fans or to your audience, that notion of freedom. But in terms of fragmented storytelling, and then you've kind of opened it up perhaps to audience wanting to add stories in and tell it, is that more challenging?
No, it's what they want to do. They actually want to engage and tell their own stories to each other, and that's what we want them to do too. We don't have to be in the middle of all of it. We just want to enable it.
Okay.
That's the key, because the power, what's the old adage, the best form of advertising is word of mouth? Well, let's not lose that truth, okay? Just because we have all kinds of shiny things to play with now doesn't mean that the truth about people telling stories to each other is more powerful than us telling you a story. But give them a platform to work with. Give them something to engage in. Give them something, you know, to be a part of. But then let them take over from there.
Okay.
That's where the power is.
So in terms of like fragmented storytelling in real time, I think Tina the Daily Beast is quite representative of that. And I know there's a short video that they would like to show just to underpin that kind of idea of how fragmented real storytelling works. So I don't know if we could roll that video quickly, please. We'll be right back. come from a very sort of traditional storytelling background, linear traditional storytelling. How have you had to change your approach to storytelling to dial into these new ways of telling stories?
Well, I think at the Daily Beast, we sort of multi-platform our approach to storytelling. It's still absolutely key to have an understanding of what a great narrative is and where to find it. But we'll do it in different rhythms. So, for instance, on the Boston bomber story, we did 92 stories in 4 days, which is incredible, really. And each one of them, the key to each one, in a sense, was angle, point of view, looking for a completely different take, if you like, on something that people were already hearing. And secondly, going at it in different rhythms. I mean, in the middle of all that chaos, what you're actually looking for is the emotional content. Mm-hmm. You're really looking for something to understand in a sea of chaos. So on one level, we created a Storyfy page which had the constantly breaking tweets and news bursts and pictures, and we were doing the constant up to the minute, second by second, quick time, you know, every new thing that people wanted to hear. But on the other hand, we would have quintessentially brilliant storytellers like Michael Daly, for instance, in Boston, finding that kind of emotional content that you could really understand. And the two stories that people remembered most, I think, from the Daily Beast coverage that week, and which certainly went the most viral, were both stories that were absolutely human in their approach. One of them was Michael Daly's wonderful piece about the cowboy Samaritan, as he called him, who was a man in a cowboy hat that he just met in the streets of Boston, who had gone to Boston that day. He was to honor his two sons, one of whom was a vet who died in Iraq, and the other who had committed suicide, and he brought his white flags to give out to honor his sons at the marathon. Instead, he found himself using those same flags to try to staunch the blood of a man whose leg was amputated. Wow. And at the end of the piece, he tells this wonderful story of this man's little journey. And I mean, it's only a short piece. It's like about 900 words. But at the end of it, he said, you know, he'd come that day to honor his sons, and he did, because he'd actually saved the life of this young man, taking the wheelchair and running him into the tent. Mm-hmm. It was extraordinarily moving, and it was a quintessential, you know, really human little piece. The other piece that people really remembered, I think, was a fascinating piece that we published by a woman who had gone to the bomber's mother for facials, and who remembers going to her crowded apartment in Boston, and she just summed up in a few hundred words. You suddenly got a picture, a vignette, of what those people were like, how they lived, the crowded apartment, the sense of slight downward mobility, the mother who was already beginning to become somewhat obsessed with religion, and you just got a snapshot in time of something that was vivid and real and human. Those are the things I think that people really connect to. But at the same time, you know, we were doing the constant uptick of that news. So I think that you really have to be very versatile in the rhythms of working and have a kind of multi-talented group, really. I mean, I have people that I know, it's like an orchestra, you know. I know that, you know, Daly does, you know, narrative, he does emotional content, he does this. This person, Brian Reese, is fantastic at, you know, a quick time. So it is like an orchestra, and I think, you know, that's really what I think of now, not so much as a newsroom, as a kind of a news symphony in a way.
Absolutely.
Playing all the different instruments.
So many times when I've been spoken to about digital storytelling and fragmented storytelling, the musical references come up, so that it is like an orchestra, that everybody works as a team, and they're responsible for different things at different times. So the conductor would bring in the brass or bring in the strings to do what they need to do, because the pacing and the rhythm and the symphonies and all of these musical references keep coming up.
But the melody is the story.
Absolutely.
And that's the point. I mean, and without that melody, then you have to keep that melody in your head.
Yes.
And know that that's really is the continuing strand that takes people through.
So my thing very much is about that core theme and that core DNA. And I know that, you know, in fragmented storytelling and in real time, there's a danger, there's a lot of noise out there that we kind of end up just hearing stories and it's like this and we don't hook onto anything. And I think the aspirational messages behind stories are very strong. And for me, that's what gives the context that was referred to earlier. But I do know that to tell stories like this requires a commitment, because you can't just kind of put something out there and 3 weeks later decide you're bored of it and don't want to do it anymore, right? And also there's a sustainability issue, and then there's the issue of how to handle an audience and how to listen back. So I know, Jules, what you've got going on with Ridley Scott Associates is really exciting. The agreement that you've done with Machinima and YouTube is perfect for this science fiction series of shorts. It's what 18 to 34-year-old men. Sometimes I call them boys, but, you know, we know where we are with that. So how do you kind of encourage that idea? Are you going to use this as, like, an incubation model where you're going to kind of see what these directors kind of put in and test out the water and see
what's
responding
to? Absolutely. I mean, directors sometimes need to be put to task a little bit about... Often they're given a script or they're given a storyboard from an advertising agency, but this time they're coming up with their own ideas. So we've kind of put it out to about 40 of our directors, and they'll come back and it'll be a little bit of a competition to see which ones will be the best ones.
Excellent. That'll be challenging then and quite good fun. So it's sci-fi, right?
It's sci-fi.
And 10-minute?
10 to 12 minutes,
So then will you release them all at the same time, and will you kind of see what feedback is, or how will it
work? Well, that's what's fascinating for us, is that the immediate diagnostics and the data from Machinima will be so telling for us to be able to see how people are responding to these ideas and the particular content, and if the stories can grow into bigger franchises in many ways.
So in terms of listening back, you can see the data from Machinima clearly, but I suppose you anticipate Twitter conversations.
Oh, absolutely.
So how active will you be in not just listening to that, but maybe responding to that?
I think we have to participate because that's now, and it's the future. I mean, we can only do so much. I mean, there's a lot of questions asked on a regular basis about the films, but, you know, Ridley's great at reaching out. He stays young and current by contributing and communicating with the audience. So.
Excellent. I think there's a short video to show for that too. If we could roll that, please.
We believe that the future of viewing and experiencing content is rapidly changing.
Timeline on that?
Well, hopefully by the end of the year. I mean, we're just in the middle of getting the ideas. We read them this weekend. So Machinima and Ridley and I will review them, and we'll go pretty quickly. There's been great interest, so it's going to move fast.
That's exciting. So one of the things I always find, projects that I've worked on, where they're telling great stories with a core theme, there's a very strong message, and there's this kind of philosophy of listening back to the audience, I've kind of find there's a lot of different behaviors from the audience. I think that there are evangelists, and these are the ones that really love what you're doing, and they actually perhaps want to add to your stories. There are advocates, which are the ones that will like and share and retweet. There are what I call the gardeners, are the people that would like to come in and help you keep it tidy, but not perhaps be accredited with anything for that. And then there are the disruptors, and they're the guys that come in and spray graffiti over everything. I mean, Tina, do you find you have to deal with that kind of behavior through the Daily Beast?
Well, obviously there are, you know, the wreckers and the kind of, you know, the kind of the noisy loudmouths who get onto the comments stuff. But, you know, we really find ways to just filter that out. Actually, what we do find more of is a very if you create an open platform on a particular subject, you can create a really very interesting and civilized debate. I mean, we actually did a great open platform discussion on "I love my gun because" about, you know, gun control. Well, we actually had people talking about why they had guns, because we keep hearing from the other side, in a sense, why they love their guns. Yeah. And actually, it was very interesting. I mean, there were all kinds of very impassioned, very sort of educated, you know, defenses of firearms and other people disagreeing. We did the same thing during the abortion debate, where we actually had an open platform about where people discussed their own abortion or what they felt about it. And they were terrific conversations with readers. And I think that if you sort of create that kind of audience that are used to being informed by something smart, you'll find that they are your community.
Yeah.
And that, in a sense, is self-censoring. And I think you only get that community by rejection. I firmly believe that that just complete open sourcing when it comes to editing, you know, you're going to get dross, because dross forces out the good.
Yeah.
So we've created the the audience of the Daily Beast, high level, frankly, in demographic and sort of response, is because we've actually reject. You know, we only publish pieces that we think are really good.
Yeah.
And as a result, that kind of lifts up in a self-excluding way the people who want to take part.
And I think it's that often frights off more traditional storytellers, that notion of the control and the curatorial element. But I think what you've just said actually explains that to knock out the bad ones, mm-hmm. right? Gives you that kind of level of quality. Do you find from those comments then sometimes you find new stories?
Yes, I do actually. Sometimes I find new writers too.
Really?
Because because if someone does a long, long comment that's really smart and interesting, I mean, we will contact them and say, how about writing for us? Mm-hmm. And they do sometimes. And exactly. So I always read it. I mean, I definitely read it because I think it's very important to know what your readers and users are thinking and saying. And also it's a great talent source.
Okay, excellent. And how about you, Mark? How do you find that with Harley? Because I think that, you know, there could always be that flip side with Harley-Davidson. There's the whole Hell's Angels kind of thing, right? There could be negative.
We got a few disruptors out there.
Yeah, right. So how do you handle that?
We let it go.
Okay.
You know, I mean, let it go. Our whole thing is about freedom, so are we going to tell them exactly how to do it and what to do and where to do it? No, I mean, our whole thing is about creating the opportunity for them to do their thing.
Okay.
Now we can't, you know, get into the, you know, what's gang behavior and all that kind of stuff. But you know, for the most part, our entire community is just people that are looking to have fun and be more their unique selves.
Okay.
That's really all they're about. So we just try to create the moments for them to be more about that, whether it's through technology. Mm-hmm. But even technology, we want to get it into the touch. So we don't really do tech for tech. We do tech for touch. We want them to be out there touching the world, experiencing the world, experiencing each other. And it's not about the relationship with us. It's about their own relationship, which ultimately benefits us.
Okay.
And it's that keeps it alive. You know, I want to go on this stories thing for a second, because sometimes the stories we tell ourselves are not true.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I want to ask the audience, who believes here that baby boomers are aging? Okay. Who here believes that everybody is aging? Okay. Who believes the baby boomers are going to leave this giant generational hole for us Gen Xers to sort of suffer through until we get to Gen Y and millennials? Well, if you follow the US Census, the number of Caucasian men 35 to 74 today is about 50 million people. Those are all stories that we tell each other. Those all things, like I said, are true. In 2020, there'll be 50 million Caucasian men 35 to 74. In 2030, there'll be 50 million. Wait for it, 2040, 50 million. So this idea that different people, different generations, the stories we tell each other, well, that's true, so we have to react to that. It's really, these are sort of mythologies we create or that we hear, we pick up, and then we retell that story, and it's actually not true, and it gets in our way. And these are the surfacey things mm-hmm. that keep us from getting into the individual stories that really are the important stories.
Yeah.
And what's the real truth that we're looking for versus these kind of generational constructs that don't mean anything.
Okay. So, like, this year is it 110-year anniversary?
110
for
years, yeah, yeah.
So I know that
not me.
Not you, no. Well, you know, these millennials aren't aging.
Yeah, not yet, right.
But I know in a conversation we'd had about the behaviours around social networks and communities, because Harley has been in existence for 110 years, do you think that as a brand, there's kind of a philosophy that comes of knowing how to handle your fans or your consumers?
Yeah, so we've had a group called the Harley Owners Group for 30 years. 1983 it started, it's a million people around the world. It's a social network.
Mm-hmm.
No computers involved. It's a social network of experiences out in the road, out in the real world, telling people stories, word of mouth, all the great things that you build a brand on, because the brand is really owned by them. We can own the trademarks. We don't enforce trademarks if it's tattooed on your skin.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay if you get it slightly wrong.
Yeah, right.
It's all right. So you just let it go. I mean, that's an example. You want to tattoo our brand on your skin, go for it. We're not gonna get into that with you, but yeah. We're glad you do it. So social networking is a human trait. It's mm-hmm. it's a lot less to do with the technology and a lot more to do with what's the humanity underneath it, just like great stories or just like great news stories.
Mm-hmm.
It is the center of all this, and I think we confuse ourselves very, very often
mm-hmm.
by assuming some sense of control or assuming some of these generational generalities and thinking those are true, so they just get in our way.
Okay.
And we don't dig deep enough.
So the notion of layering experiences to your audience to make them, I mean, I'm always looking at how you can balance inclusivity against exclusivity, right? To how to make everyone feel welcome and involved, but also to feel special. How can you kind of balance that? And that's really a question for the three of you. Maybe I'll start with you on that, Jules. How will you find that maybe you can make people be part of what's happening with Ridley Scott Associates and Machinima, that they feel involved and listened to, so they feel quite exclusive and special, but yet open it so everybody can be involved? Does that come from the conversation?
Yeah, I think for sure. It's accessibility, isn't it? I mean, to be included, you want to be able to have access to anything. So if you can speak back and forth with somebody about an idea or about a story or with a filmmaker, then you do feel included and that you're a part of this exclusive club. So, but it's the way of the world now, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you rarely can you come up with an opinion or how you feel about something on your own because you open your iPad in the morning and you look at the news. But I think, it's actually nice to see something fresh when you can and weigh in immediately, but then ride out the wave of what it becomes.
Okay, and what about for you, Tina? I mean, I suppose by finding stories in unexpected places where you have commenters who kind of interact with you, you are making those people that you might ask to be new writers feel very special and included.
I think one of the things that we try to do is we identify what I think of as obsessionals. And the obsessional is certain stories, everybody just wants to know everything about them. And one of the things we do, I think, very successfully at the Daily Beast is sense when a story is going to become an obsessional. And then when that happens, I just throw everything at it and mine that vein to the point that then it is no longer interesting. Then you have to know when to get out of it as well.
Mm-hmm.
But it's great, I think, to one way you develop a community, in a sense, is understanding what obsesses your audience at certain times. Now, it could be a whole different range of things. It could be the Amanda Knox story. It could be the Rupert Murdoch phone hacking. It could be, you know, some, an angle of the Boston bombing, whatever. But you have to understand that story, that feels like an obsessional, and then go deep, deep, deep into it and give it all you've got.
Yeah.
And I actually believe in not trying to do everything. You know, I hire writers for how they think as much as how they write.
Nice.
And then I hire those intellects that I think are questioning and are counterintuitive and are always going to have a kind of a point of view about the culture in some way. And then I'll go with their obsession. And I like to delve into it. For instance, I mean, we have a brilliant young national security writer called Eli Lake. Now, did I say, okay, the Daily Beast is going to specialize in national security? No, it wasn't the first thing on my mind. However, Eli has got such an interesting mind that whatever he wants to write about, I don't care if it's cyber spying or Benghazi, you know, situation or what's going on in Russia, he just has an interesting mind. And he's able to develop from his own point of view a sort of a following. And people follow voices, you know, they want a voice that they can follow. So at The Beast, you know, we really have developed these different voices that people follow.
Yeah.
And, you know, we have all kinds of odd people who are not necessarily covering a beat. For instance, I have a correspondent who in Afghanistan who is just totally, you know, in cahoots with the Taliban in every way. This guy, if you want a quote from the Taliban, this guy's your guy, right? So you might think, well, why do you want a guy who, you know, who knows so much about the Taliban? Just because he's so good and so interesting that he brings this angle to everything. I mean, like when the Boston bombing happened, he was right in there with the head of the Taliban saying, did you do it?
Well.
And they said, no, we didn't do this. On the record, he said, we didn't do this. He said, you know, we don't want people to think we're terrorists, which I thought was amusing. but that's the kind of thing that we can do on The Beast, which just, it's angle, you know, it's about coming at things from a different point of view.
Yes.
And so for that, you need people who think interestingly.
So I think really, I mean, the title of this session is called Finding Your Story, right? So what you've just spoken about is real-time journalism as well as real-time storytelling. And I think for the three of you, that's going to feature in lots of different ways with all of your projects. And I just wondered, I mean, I know we're kind of getting short on time, but if there was one thing that you had to say, if there was any brands that felt they couldn't find their story, and I know from projects I've worked on, it's really hard to define that core theme. And I've been working on a project. It took me a year to figure out what the core theme of the story was. The minute I realized it, everything literally fell into place because that behavior of that core theme affected many of my characters in different ways. So if there was any advice you could give to anybody that might feel they can't find their story, do you have like any words of wisdom or nuggets that you might like to share?
I mean, I know what we do in terms of whether it's scripts, whether it's movie making, TV shows, when it gets out of hand or we feel like we're lost our way, we go back to the simplicity and the core of what the brand is, or what the product is. It seems to me that that natural core will always bring you back to what you really need to be saying. I mean, with that said, I think you have to take risks and you have to try things and always end up going back to it. Yeah. But if not, then you're a bit stayed.
Yeah, because that core theme informs the orchestra, right? That's what makes everyone know what they're doing. Yeah. Mark Huns?
Yeah, I guess I would say the first step would be find your meaning, not your tagline.
Nice.
Not your campaign. Mm-hmm. And then get that meaning to be talked about between them, not just from you to them. Because really telling your story to them is a lot less interesting than them telling a meaningful story to somebody else. But if you provide that meaning, that is a great brand. It's meaningful to them, it's part of their life. And that could be any kind of product. Yeah. It could be a funny experience, it could be a deep experience, but if that meaning is, if they're living that, they'll tell that to other people.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily have to be involved. You just have to create the environment, the engagement for that, and then they'll take over. But you got to know the meaning is first.
Yeah. So in a time when there's a lot of noise and a lot of fragmented storytelling, I still believe, despite perhaps what Douglas had said, that the core theme is so important because that informs everybody.
I think the success of narrative television at the moment absolutely proves that point. I mean. Mm-hmm. The whole thing we just heard about binge-watching House of Cards, there is a reason why people are binge-watching House of Cards. The world is so full of fragmentation,
yes.
So full of noise, that actually what people want to do is go home to their house and hole up with a narrative. Yeah. And that's why Homeland and these stories, which are so deeply immersive, which have a real continuation of character and plot who that you can live with and get to know and understand their lives, that's one of the reasons I think that they're enjoying such an enormous vogue at the moment. Because people don't want to have the quick, short procedural anymore. Their whole life is a quick, short procedural. They want to actually, escape into something far more meaningful, to take your point.
And I think they're the core things that we need to look at, really. I mean, in terms of telling stories, is who we're telling the stories to, how they behave on a host of different platforms, and how we can create experiences for them that are true to our core theme and message, but also they can consume in bite-sized chunks, or watch, the binge viewing on House of Cards. I lost sleep watching that thing, so I thought it was so great. So I know we're out of time, and seriously, there are so many more things that we could speak about up here, but I know we're restricted to 20 minutes, so thank you for listening, and thank you to Tina, Mark Hands.
Thank you, Alison.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.